Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Are you awake today, people of God? Let's thank her for that beautiful music and rendition of Joyful, Joyful today. We thank you much, Linda, for all you do. Well, I think I tired out the church yesterday. You tired?
Yeah.
Those of us who are tired. It was a wonderful day for the back-to-school bash is what I'm talking about. We had approximately 500 people come, and we figured that out from backpacks given and hot dogs eaten and T-shirts that we needed extra ones of, and it was a phenomenal day. I want you to hear this, and this church needs a pat on the back, because we gave out approximately $12,000 worth of school supplies. Let's celebrate that. That's let alone all the food, all of the energy. Those of us who are, I'm kind of waiting for that nap later in the afternoon. All of us who did that was amazing. I want to thank every one of you now for your contributions, whether it was chips or applesauce or baked beans or school supplies throughout the year. This was a powerful, powerful outreach to our community. I want you right now to turn to a neighbor and say thank you for your participation. Find someone and say that to them right now. It's so important to hear from someone directly, and we've just done that we really appreciate. That is what it means to be church. We welcome everybody. We welcome those of you online, and glad that you are with us, and thank you for your contribution as you send your money in to the offering, your offerings into the office, and we celebrate all of this together, that we continue to live that mission of share Christ, serve community, and grow disciples. Yesterday was a fantastic day, and the community knows who we are as we reach out to share the word of Jesus. Okay, let's turn to the next slide, which is that those of us who participated yesterday, anyone that participated or is kind of a lead person in the event, we're gonna have a meeting at 9:30, and this is open to anybody that wants to come. 9:30 on the 18th of August, during that Sunday school hour, we're gonna meet in room 11. We're gonna just talk through all the different things. There's a number of different things I've heard circulating that we wanna remember for next year. We'll take notes, and then that'll be ready as we plan this event again for next year. Next announcement is that for our youth, the 11th next Sunday is Family Fun Day, with lots of opportunity as you gather in the pavilion for all kinds of fun, and we invite you to sign up on the I Worship Today card so Pastor Carey has an idea who's coming. And we invite you to do that. And then the following week is a great event called Messy Games. And it is at Epiphany. If we can go to that slide, please. The 18th. And this is synod-wide messy games, all kinds of shaving cream and all kinds of messy things. Toothpaste and baked beans and I don't know what else. Just use your imagination. Should be a lot of fun. See Pastor Carey if you're interested.
No toothpaste. Just shaving cream and color.
And color. No baked beans?
No baked beans.
Okay. Well, that's my imagination. Whatever. So we're glad that they're having that opportunity. Please sign up to be a part of that. And then for us to be church together, which is an important part of our life in Christ, we're going to have a congregation picnic on August the 25th. It will occur at noon right after this service. We'll go outside and hopefully the weather's good out there. If not, we'll go downstairs and we'll have the congregation picnic. If you are going to participate in that, please sign up on your iWorship today. Let us know what you're planning to bring, as the instructions in the bulletin say, so that we can begin to get an understanding of what's going to be here. And we'll have the food, the meat is provided. Is that correct, ladies? Meat is provided and drinks are provided. But if you would, please sign up. Please sign up. Okay? All right. At this time, I'm going to invite us to stand as we begin to worship. Let's do so by greeting one another. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us greet one another, wave across the aisle there. Peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord, peace of the Lord to you.
Psalm 78 from the Message. God help them anyway, commanded open the gates of heaven. They ate the bread of the mighty angels.
God sent them all the food they could eat.
Help us to open our hearts to God in the same way. Let us join in our hymn of praise.
Mm-hmm. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And we'll guard each one's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. All praise to the Father from whom all things come. And all praise to Christ Jesus, his only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Let us pray. O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this world in all its need with the life that comes only from you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our readings for today.
First reading is from Exodus chapter 16. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" The word of the Lord. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 4. "I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. but each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children, tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth and building itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very, very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because of signs, you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for food that perishes, but for food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you, for it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in whom he has sent." So they said to him, What sign are you going to give us then, so that we might see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you bread from heaven, but it was my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The gospel of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. A century and a half ago, a group of ex-soldiers were working to build a sawmill on the American Fork River in Western California. Their promised wages were $1.50 a day. Nothing to sneeze at it back in those days. But while blasting away the dirt from the new mill channel, one of the men saw a golden sparkle on the rocks that were buried. The year was 1848, and the California gold rush would soon start, all because some workmen found something much more valuable than what they were looking for. Brothers and sisters in Christ, today Jesus tells the crowd that what he wants to give them is much more valuable than what they come looking for. Large crowds of people, as we begin our gospel lesson, are looking for Jesus today. And no wonder, Jesus has just provided them a wonderful meal. They all ate their fill, if we remember the words from the gospel last week. And who doesn't like getting a free meal? Jesus knows, though, he knows the intent of their hearts. They wanted him to essentially become their bread king, as Pastor Carey pointed out so well in the sermon last week. But let's examine that concept a little more deeply, a bread king. For Jesus to keep providing free bread, free meals for them is one thing. It's a good thing. But he tells them in the text today, this is not what I am totally about. Then why did he do it in the first place, we might ask? Well, all miracles always cause questions, so listen carefully. No doubt, Jesus is very strategic with every miracle in all of the gospels that he makes. Every miracle that Jesus offers is for a reason, and that reason is normally more than way bigger than the individual person affected. Each miracle has a kingdom implication. Each miracle also gives us a hint at who our living God is. For example, to create food for thousands of people was meant as a sign pointing to the people to see Jesus as who he was, as the Almighty Son of God. And yet, the crowd in our text today has followed him. If we go back into chapter 5, they start there, they follow him, they followed him around the lake 2 weeks ago, they followed him last week, and now they follow him again, this time even taking a boat across the lake. They're following him with the intent of finding another free meal. And so Jesus says to them in our text, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because of you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves." You know, I love Jesus' words to the crowd, "You ate your fill," but "you ate your fill" doesn't really translate well from the original language into English, because the word that Jesus uses for eating your fill was a word used for grazing animals. In fact, Jesus was accusing the people of showing all the spiritual insight of grazing animals, worried about only filling their bellies. And so the crowds were treating Jesus with as much spiritual interest as they would a fast food restaurant with free tacos sign in the window. With this, Jesus becomes very clear to his disciples, he and to the crowd, he doesn't want to be a bread king. He doesn't want to be their bread king at all and just only fill their bellies. He's more about more than just that. Rather, he comes for a bigger purpose. Bigger purpose. I mean, this is poignant. It causes me to ask questions about my own spiritual life. Have we ever made that mistake spiritually with our Lord? Have we ever come to Jesus only looking for our needs to be met? I know I have. Don't we sometimes go looking for Jesus, not so that we can really listen to what he has to say to us, but simply to get what we want? Do we turn to Jesus in prayer only when we need something and then ignore him again as soon as that crisis is over? Do we do that? You don't need to raise your hand. Could our worship ever be self-centered, thinking we come here only for ourselves and what we can get out of it, instead of wanting to be fed by our Lord and communicate with our brothers and sisters in the faith and share our love and praise of God? You know, over the years, I've learned when people make relationships only about what they can get out of them and not about the others in which they are in relationship with, that if you follow that track too much in those relationships, it causes brokenness and separation and pain and frustration and anger. Because the reality is that sin is separation. Sin is what keeps us apart from another, from our God, sin. Now, God is surely the source of every blessing in our life, but Jesus is redefining his purpose in chapter 6 of John's gospel. That his purpose is not a temporal purpose with temporal real bread out of wheat or whatever, but rather his purpose is an eternal purpose with an eternal mission. His bigger purpose is to be the bread of life. And because of this, he has something better to offer than what the crowds come asking for. And he says it this way in our text: do not work for the food that perishes, or another translation says spoils, but rather the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of God, Son of Man, will give to you. You see, Jesus' greatest gift to you and to me is not the daily bread that he gives us so generously. We thank him for our daily bread in the Lord's Prayer, don't we? We pray for daily bread. He provides for us regularly. And yet he has a bigger gift than all of that. And that is the faith that he gives us that is placed in our heart. A faith that enables us to meet the grind of life and all that happens in it. A faith that enables us to make hard choices in this life when we're forced to. A faith that's based in a living relationship with him. A faith that gives us the gift of eternity. Jesus' words hit home with those first hearers. They were convicted in their hearts of being selfish and shallow. And so they asked him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" quote in the scripture today. Now, it seems with those words, it seems like the people are okay, they're now on track. But they still are missing the point. Now they were looking to Jesus not as the bread king, but now as a spiritual advisor, kind of like a heavenly version of Dear Abby, if you will. Okay, Jesus, tell me what rules we are to follow and what paths we're to take. I'll work hard. I'll earn that heavenly banquet you're talking about. Just show me the way where God wants me to go. You see, they still don't get what Jesus is saying. Jesus is not vying for the position of spiritual advisor. He's not giving good tips on living, although much of his teaching provides lots of truth. He's not about pointing out the loopholes of the law so that they can avoid it and work their way so that life is easy. Rather, Jesus is about inviting them and us into a living, living relationship. And therefore, he's not coming as bread king. He's not coming as spiritual advisor, but rather he comes to us as a grace-granting savior. Jesus answered those people, and he says, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." And so Jesus didn't come to show you how you can convince God that your sin doesn't matter or that you're really a good person, whatever that means. Nor does Jesus come to help us get what we want in this life. He's not a Sears and Roebuck cat. I know that's an old analogy. Rather, Jesus comes to give us the gift of life, eternal life, that begins now and expands into forever. Our text ends with these words, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty." So now the question today for us is, what does this mean for us? The good Lutheran question, right? What does this mean? What is Jesus asking of us? Well, Jesus' message is consistent throughout all of Scripture, and summed up, it's like this. Life is not about us. We see that today with Jesus' remarks to the crowd. Rather, life is found in relationship with God and in relationship with each other. The crowd that day is really representative of all humanity. By nature, we human beings think first of ourselves. What's mine? What can I have? Don't forget me. And secondly, how can I control life to get it to go the way I want it to? Jesus' message summed up is this: get over yourself. Think of others. Meet their needs. There you will find life. You see, the crowd's mindset that day simply just doesn't work. And for many who try to live this way, it leads only to frustration and separation and the ultimate separation, death. Get over yourself and lean into God. That's what Jesus is saying. Because God comes to us in grace and is wholly unimpressed with your resumes and mine as well. He's not impressed with what we've done or where we've been or what we've accomplished. That doesn't impress him. God rather seeks a real living relationship with you and with me. The French sociologist Jacques Ellul writes a book called Living Faith, and in it he makes this point that if we have faith for what we can receive from God, then this belief is not really faith at all. He writes these words, quote, "The really unbearable thing for us is grace. Because while it is, to be sure, the expression of infinite love, it is also totally gratuitous. You can't buy it or exchange it. You can't deal for it or get the hang of it. You'll go nowhere with influence, with indulgences, with collusion. Grace is the hardest thing for us to be reconciled to because it implies the renouncing of our pretensions, of our power, our pomp, and our circumstance." Then later he says, "If you believe in God in order to be protected and shielded or healed or saved, then it's not faith, because faith is gratuitous." You see, this will prove shocking, especially to Protestants who have talked so much about salvation through faith, about faith as the condition of salvation, that they end up saying, "You believe, so you'll be saved." But we have to keep coming back to grace and its gratuitousness. If God loves us and saves humankind without asking any price, the counterpart of this is that God intends to be believed and loved without self-interest, purpose, simply for nothing, unquote. Primarily, relationship is what it's all about. Simply put, God is free to act as God wills and is under no obligation to us other than the obligation that God feels to God's own presence. The reason that God moves towards us in grace, most especially within the movement of the Christ or the bread of life today, is entirely within God's own will and way and not because of what lies within us. It's not about us. Or said another way, God loves us because God loves us. The reason is in God and not in us. Ultimately, this means we are free as well to respond to God's grace movement as we will, either in believing the love or the indifference and rejection. This kind of alternative is what fosters true relationship. And Jesus confronts the crowds this day with such a choice. This point of view creates a life full of meaning, full of purpose. Jesus offers us a partnership, a relationship with the living God that begins now and goes into eternity. He invites us to come along on a journey. He invites us to be in mission with him and for him. He invites us to be on his team and builds the kingdom and caring for one another. We trust God's provision, the bread of life, no matter what happens. This is the better bread that Jesus offers to a crowd only coming to fill their bellies. This is the eternal bread of life. One final brief story for you all to ponder. A holy man rested beneath a tree at the outskirts of the city. One day he was interrupted by a man who ran to him saying, the stone, please give me the stone. This man told the holy man about a dream in which an angel had spoken to him of a man outside the city who would give him a stone and make him rich forever. And so the holy man reached into his pocket and pulled out a large diamond. Here, he said, the angel probably spoke of this. I found it on my journey here. If you want it, you can have it. I mean, the diamond was as big as his fist and perfect in every way. And the man marveled at its beauty and clutched it in his hands eagerly. And then the man ran away. But that night, a man was restless in his sleep. He couldn't stop thinking. And so in the morning, he returned to dawn to the holy man, and he said, the wealth, give me the wealth that lets you so easily give away that large diamond. This is for you to ponder. As you remember, Jesus is the bread of life. Amen. This time we continue with confession and forgiveness. I would invite all to rise. Gracious God, who would give us the bread of life, we come to you to enter into a living relationship. And like all relationships, at times we need to clear the air. We come to you in confession, trusting in your gracious care. At times we make life all about us. We make life about possessions more than people. We make life to be about our desires instead of helping others. Forgive us for not entering fully into a relationship with you. Forgive us for our selfishness. Forgive us for making life all about me. People of God, God loves you all for you, for who you are. Through the death and resurrection of Jesus, God forgives all your sin and offers you a living relationship. God wants to partner in life with you. Go live life anew in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let us sing.
Confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Calling on the Spirit of wisdom to guide our hearts and our minds, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Please be seated. Let us pray. O wise one, your wisdom has been present in this world since its beginning. Pour out your wisdom into the hearts of the whole church, especially the newly baptized lay leaders, deacons, pastors, and bishops. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Holy God of all creation, you are the source of all life. Where the sun blazes hard and strong, bring a gentle breeze. In the places experiencing the cold of winter, bring your warmth. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Compassionate God, help government leaders of this world unite for peace and justice. Humble all who hold authority, that power is directed toward a more just society. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bread of life from heaven, you feed us. Fill all who hunger with needed nutrition, and open our hearts to eliminate hunger in this world. May we see the day when all are fed. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
O wisdom of truth, help us to understand your will for the church. Be with congregations experiencing transition, redevelopment, and the exciting yet frightening path of newness. May your wisdom be found at every step. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Redeeming God, we give you thanks for the lives and witness of our saints now departed. Bring your beloved into eternal glory, opening wide the gates to the heavenly banquet. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for our church family and those we name aloud or silently in our hearts, that all experience the healing and comfort given through Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. All are welcome to come to the table. We invite you to be seated at this time as you gather together your I Worship Today sheet as well as your offering. Again, we are in our bread cycle, and so our communion is a little different than normal in that you will come to me. I will be centered here with bread. You will receive bread, then you will go to the sides where you can dip it then into the wine, or there is a brown chalice with grape juice before returning to your seats.
Your
Forever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
In peace, serve the Lord. Through Christ, share Christ, serve communion, grow disciples.